It's like, so I do a talk when I'm at conferences. I do a talk. It's like where I've got like PowerPoints. It's got kittens. It's wonderful. It's like, you know, all different kinds of themes, and I do different talks. I do a rant talk one year. I do a offensive. Well, most of my talks are offensive, but you know, an offensive talk or defensive talk the next year. But when I talk to like groups or colleges and like, you know, groups like this, it's like I don't do talks because it's like I don't like talking at people in this kind of settings. I do like a Q&A kind of thing. So what I first do is I show you some red team stuff. I show you that this is what I do as a red teamer. This is how I can break things. So you know I'm not full of crap when I talk about red team stuff. And then I bring out the whiteboard and I show you some defensive things that you can do at your company and stuff, and show you that it's like, okay, I'm not full of crap when I talk about blue team stuff. So now that you realize I'm not full of crap, it's like you can start asking me questions. And that's the whole thing, is you asking me questions. And when I say that you're asking me questions, if you don't come up with a question, I start randomly picking people in the crowd to come up with a question for everybody. So there's going to be questions, okay? The only problem is if you're going to volunteer it or not. But I promise you there will be questions. So that's how that rolls and stuff. So so here's how we do blue team stuff. So what's one of our biggest problems? How many people here do information security for your day job who actually try to secure things? What's one of the biggest problems it's like that you have with that? It's like, how do you detect when a bad guy's on your network? Okay, there's been so much talk. It's like, you know, up until recently, it's like, I think it's been the last couple of years, we've been so obsessed with building bigger walls. You know, it's like, we got to build walls. It's like, we got to make them higher. We're going to make Mexico pay for it. No, it's like, wrong wall. It's like, it's been a rough political season in my country, okay? It's like, so it's like, but in blue team, it's like, we want to make those walls bigger and, you know, the firewalls, and we got IPSs, and they're not going to be able to get in. But they get in. It's like, so I think we need to change that. We got to shift that paradigm and stop trying to figure out how big we build the walls. How quickly do we detect when the walls are breached? How quickly can we respond to a breach of the wall? And so I'm going to show you some things that cost you $0. I am not selling you a blinky box and stuff that you put on your network that magically solves your APT problem, okay? It's like, I'm going to show you some things that you can take tomorrow, put into your environment, and actually help quickly detect if there's a breach or someone doing something bad on your network, because that's what you wanted to detect. You wanted to detect when someone is doing something bad. The very first one is, what is the key goal of an attacker? It's like, when you're trying to go in, what do you want? Well, you want access. You want to go after root. You want to go after domain admin. No one goes in trying to break in hoping they can get the credentials of the mailroom guy, right? It's like, oh, I'm going to get the mailroom guy. Oh, yeah. No, you want domain admin. You want the root user. So my solution and a good detector is I say give it to them. Literally. It's like you create a domain account that actually says this is what you write the account. You don't have to make it this, but this is what I would do it as: ADM TMP. Create that user ID. Give it domain admin. Put it in the domain admin's group. In the description field, you type password is password one. And that is a great password because everybody uses it, so you know it's good. So that's a secure password. And then you also put in little things like this, delete November 2015. And you put that in the description field. Seriously. But one little thing that you should add, you should definitely add. Do not do this unless you add this one little section. Login hours. Under that section of login hours, you put equals zero. What does that mean? It doesn't lock out. They never lock out. That is a legitimate password. That is a legitimate account. They just can't ever log into it. But what does it do? It generates an alert. You can script to an email that notifies you that someone has popped your domain controller, has found domain admin, and is trying to use that to log into a box, and it'll give you the IP address of the box that it's trying to log into. So you've just as detected an actual zero false positive attack on your network. There is no false positives to that. Someone's up to some shady stuff if they're accessing that, right? So there you go. No blinky boxes, but you've got an actual breach. Another one to use is a 1x1 pixel GIF. Or GIF. I'm not getting in a freaking GIF for you, okay? We're going to call it a GIF. It's like that GIF. And you're going to put a link to that. And what does this link go to? An email. Because how big is a 1.1 pixel GIF? It's tinier than this, okay? It's really small, okay? Who accidentally clicks on that? You would have to be some OCD mother... You're just searching, looking. Right there it is. No, you don't do that, right? It's like, but what does click on that link? Bots, spiders, web scanners, Nikto, OpenVAS, it's like Nessus. Those all click on those links. And what happens when you click on it? It goes to a site that collects the user agent string, the IP address, the operating system, and the window variable of the actual, and the of the device, or whatever it was that was using it. Now, you also have to set up rules on that site. It's like you can script this where you can actually whitelist user agents, because that way you whitelist the Google bots and the Baidu bots and all those other spiders that are actually just doing the spidering, so you can start actually picking up the actual attacks when they're hitting that link, because scammers are scraping that site to probably do a possible phishing attack. It's like OpenVAS is using it, Nessus is using it. That's an indicator of not zero false positives, but once it's finally tuned, you get a lot less false positives, and you know exactly who's trying to actually scam and trying to possibly attack your website before they actually start the attack. Now, another thing is, talking about those kind of things, is user agent strings. We have a robot.txt, right? With no one actually uses ever anymore, but we still have it. But why don't you create something like that that blocks based on user agent strings? You can actually create and craft and develop your website that it blocks certain user agent strings to go and visit your website. You don't exist if they have that in their user agent string. And what are some of the user agent strings that you want to block from actually looking? How about OpenVAS? Yep, Nikto. Is there any time that Nikto is going to your website and that's going to be good for you? Ever? No. You're going to have a bad day, okay? It's like, and a lot of people come up to me and say, when I've done that, they say, yeah, Jayson, but can't the attacker and stuff, change the user agent strings? Like, well, yeah, but that would take work and actually skill. And these things aren't going to do skill. Most criminals aren't going to be changing the user agent strings. You know why? Because they're criminals. They're not hackers. They're not attackers. They're just criminals. They're just using the default settings. They're following the tutorial they saw on YouTube on how to hack and make money, right? They don't learn how to do those kind of things. Do you know how many people you could pop on Kali Linux and Backtrack Linux because you knew you could SSH into their box and go user root, password Tor? Seriously, how many people? It was so bad that Kali Linux actually has to create during the install and prompt you to change the mother effing password because they know you're not doing it. There's one guy that was at a CTF and all he did was go in and SSH into all the boxes and RMRF every single freaking backtrack Linux box there was, because they all had the same epic password. Okay? It's like, trust me, user agent strings, those are the guys you're going to catch. If you've got something where it's like the, where it's a skilled attacker, where it's someone that's actually trying to do some APT mother stuff on you, okay, that's not going to help you. But the domain controller thing might save your bacon. Another thing you can do is shared folders. We all have network shares, right? Trust me, I've been reading the lines on CryptoLocker. A lot of people have a lot of network shares, okay? So we all have network shares. So create a network share. And you put it on an everyone write and read folder and stuff, you know, and you call it private or something, you know, something generic. And then inside this folder that is everyone, I don't know how to spell everyone. There you go. I've had a very long month, people, okay? I'm not working at 100% efficiency here. And if you put, but in the folder, you put in payroll. I felt bad. I almost put an E there. I'm very proud of myself right now. Payroll.xls. Make it 4 megs or greater. Is that lesser? It's one of those. We're good, right? So you make it one of those. You can't put it 0. You can't make it 1 kilobyte. No one's going to fall for that, okay? You've got to put a size to it, okay? And that one is deny all. So what happens is you've got a folder on a share, on a drive, that no one should ever be accessing. But people can find if they're up to no good and they're looking around and they're trying to scan your shares. Then you put a file in there that everybody wants to open. And you put it where you remove all permissions on it. So what happens when they click on that? It generates an email with the user ID that actually tried to do it, the domain admin, the domain account that tried to log into it and try to take it down. It shows the IP address of the machine or the name of the machine, and it sends an email letting you know, hey, someone's up to no good. 0 false positives, 0 blinky boxes. It's like, and you've got an actual notification of an actual someone doing something bad on your network. So hopefully these things that you can take back to your work and say, hey, I've got this great idea, let's do this stuff. Because, like, quite honestly, I got all this stuff from Mubix. It's like, he did a great talk, and I referenced it on a tweet I did a while back. So, I mean, I still mostly all this, well, the 1.1 pixel GIF and some of the other stuff I did. But those top things, is like, all were from him. So it's like, I mean, I'm just sharing the knowledge. Those are some good blue team things. So hopefully now I've established that, you know, I'm not full of crap on the red team. I'm not totally full of crap on the blue team. So what time is it now? No one say howdy duty time. It's like maybe lost in translation. What time is it now? Question and answers. Who said that first? I think it was you. So what was your question? Wasn't that sudden? It was just wham! It's like, okay, I'll let you off the hook on this one. Okay. Anybody have a question before I do pick on him? So you better start thinking of one because you're the first target. Yes?
So, question sort of the blue team problem and right. What you encountered in the sort of bank branch show, but others. Their problems aren't anything like this. Their problems are they employ a bunch of human beings who are more concerned about, you know, held up in denied budgetary approval to upgrade my equipment for 3 consecutive years than keeping complete strangers out of their own branch.
Right. What you have to do is, one of the biggest fundamental problems we have with information security as it relates to the business unit and stuff, you know, and trying to get corporate management buy-in to the process is upper management executives are reactionary. They react. Executive management has been taught through marketing, through their skills and stuff, how to react to situations, not to be proactive. Information security and security, we are proactive by nature. So the conundrum has always been, how do we get management to react in a proactive manner? And that's up to us to start creating what I call situational awareness for the executives. Start showing them things in the news, showing things that could apply to you and how that will negatively impact their business and their ability to perform, their ability to profit based on a breach occurring. Show them where that happens. Show them where CryptoLocker has locked out a business and cost them thousands and thousands of dollars. Show them Target. Show them all these other companies that actually really don't get affected because it's just a profit. But show them the dangers of it. It's like, show them the negative publicity that's on some of these breaches. Show them how this could be them and give them a way to react proactively. It's like another key thing when we talk about management is once they understand the problem in terms that they understand. Security, we love talking to management like they're pointy-haired bosses or the users are stupid. And that's not true. It's like management has gone through business school. They've gone through university. They are educated and they know exactly how to do what they are paid and hired to do, which is run a business. It is up to security to start understanding and learning to talk to management in terms that they understand to make them get the impact of what they need to do to protect their network. We start talking in jargon. We start talking in ways because we're smart and we're technical and we know what we're doing and these guys are idiots and they tune us out. They don't think that it's, they don't understand the threat because they don't understand the terminology. We failed. We failed them. They didn't fail their company. We failed the company. So you need to start being able to talk to your management and start talking to your executives in ways that they understand. And probably everybody knows executives love pie charts, right? Everybody loves pie charts. You know, everybody, graphs, you know, pie. Why aren't you using those? Create a graph about how many hits or blocks that your firewall hit gets every day, every month. It's like millions. Does it mean anything technically? No. But does it look impressive on a spreadsheet saying this is how many blocks or possible attacks that we've had on our network? Yes. Do you detect and count how many spam that you get or reject from the mail server? That's another statistic you can use. You can start creating metrics on because executives know metrics. Start creating metrics in your environment that relate to information security, that show them, that you can give them, that give them numbers, that gives them data on how they need to protect and secure their network. That's how you do that. Next question.
So, can all of this be the biggie box?
If I would, I'd be a billionaire right now. I'm like a magical unicorn waiting to go to Silicon Valley. But no, it's not. That's just putting in work. That's getting your web developers to... SQL injections. What are SQL injections when it comes down to it? It's crappy coding. There is no CVE for SQL injection. It is crappy coding. So the only way to solve SQL injections is to get your developers to start writing proper and not do crappy code. So once you can start developing that, and once you can get developers that understand how to do that security, I mean, and we talk about SQL injection, like, well, Jayson, that's so, you know, 2003. Have you checked your firewall logs? You're still getting hit with SQL Slammer. Here's a history lesson for you. DEF CON 2002, the vulnerability that led to SQL Slammer was released. September of 2002, Microsoft released the patch for the vulnerability that led to SQL Slammer. February 2003, SQL Slammer was released. Everybody went, oh my God, we're dying. It's like servers were crapping everywhere. HP just lost themselves, right? It's like it was a horrible bloodbath, right? Check your firewall logs in 2016. What are you going to see? SQL Slammer still hitting your firewall. That means there is an unpatched server connected to the internet running an outdated version of SQL Server that is vulnerable to a patch that came out in 2002. That makes you sad sometimes, okay? That's why a lot of people I know drink, okay? But that's one of the things that you have to deal with. It's like you have to deal with those kind of things. It's like if you got proper coding, you don't have to worry about that. So a lot of these are just getting your developers to think in a secure way. where I work during my day job, it's like I always praise our developers because our developers write great code. If you get a SQL, if you do a SQL tick, you know, select union or anything on our website, our corporate website, it goes back to the homepage, and then it sends an email with your IP address, your user agent string, your operating system, and it says, "Hey, this person tried some sketchy SQL stuff. You might want." And half of the time, it's actually someone saying McDonald's or something, because you got the little tick there. But those other times, it's not. It's like, and that shows that someone's actually trying to do a SQL or a manual SQL injection, or sometimes it's been mass SQL, and that's like, we've actually had a DOS on our Exchange server just because someone was doing a SQL scan on our website, okay? That was really sad because we actually hired the idiots who did that. So it's like, you gotta be careful people aren't just like, button monkeys when they're trying to test or do a pen test for you. So you just gotta have proper coding when you're doing it. So it's like it's possible. It's able to do it. It's like it doesn't need a blinky box. It just needs people to be properly trained on how to write properly. Yes. So,
I spoke to someone at Syscan who had the completely opposite opinion to that. He said that
They were wrong.
No. From the developer and made into a service. So what do you think about that? Do you think that security can ever be taken away from the developer? And just use companies to provide security.
Well, actually, I'm not even being funny. That is totally wrong. I don't believe that at all. So that's not... Developers, if they think that they're not responsible for security, they're going to be even sloppier than they are right now. It's like, secure code is not some kind of magical, I'm going to write code securely. No! I didn't say write code securely. Stop writing crappily, okay? That's the problem. It's not insecure writing developers. It's crappy developers that are causing the security breaches. It's like, so you can get all the security offshore stuff you want, it's still going to have a crappy developer. It's like, you need to get rid of that guy because your code's sluggish, it's too much lines in it, it's like it's going to lead to all these other kind of corruptions, it's going to have all these other bugs in it. Screw that. It's like, when you teach a developer, get a developer that writes securely, you're going to get a developer that writes properly, who will actually code better and more efficiently and more effectively. That's the kind of developer you want anyway. Security, at that point, is a side benefit. So, yeah, there are no insecure developers and stuff, They're just crappy developers, and there's good developers. There's no security division in there. It's just either you're crappy or you're not. Okay, and there's a lot of crap out there versus the secure writing good ones. So, I'm not very politically correct, if you can tell. So it's like, So I don't know whoever that was. Tell them. No personal. I don't want to know. But yeah, totally wrong.
Okay, so on the Facebook group, talk about having a DevCon group in Singapore. So
I was going to ask someone to make sure that got asked. But yes.
Yes. Okay. So will we be having any group in Singapore and any DJ event?
It is very, very simple to start a DEF CON group. And then, does anybody know about the NUS hackers, NUS hackers?
Yeah.
Okay. I was just there on April 1st and talked to them. They're actually starting to talk about creating one. They have a very great event. It's like, it's a really cool thing. It's like, it's in a college, though. It's a little bit more formal. It's like, I think a DEF CON group can be wherever you want it to be and stuff. I think it would be great to be here where you get corporate and you get hackers and stuff, and you get them together and you have that information sharing. That's what it's about. This is all it takes to get a DEF CON group, and I think they already started talking about one, so look for one there to be one. But it just starts just sending an email with all the information that we say on our template to submit. And then by the power of magical whoosh, fairy dust, you're a DEF CON group. And it's like, and then you're listed on the DEF CON group's website as a legitimate DEF CON group for Singapore. So that's all it takes. So yes, I do 100% expect to see one in Singapore within the next month or two. And hopefully I'll be here at a DEF CON group's meeting within the next year or so. It's like, because I'll probably be back next year for sure for some conferences. So it's like, I'll hopefully be able to attend one at the same time. So yes, there definitely. I definitely think there's going to be a DEF CON groups here in Singapore, and I think it's going to be awesome. But that's just me personally. So you know, it's like, and I'll have absolutely zero nothing to do with it. So that increases the probability of it being awesome. So that works out.
I'm actually thinking of doing it, starting up one.
Okay.
If anyone wants to join up, because in Singapore we already have meetup groups like now, and NUS Hackers and like my own NUS Grey Hats groups. But the thing that's missing in Singapore is that we don't have a CTF oriented group.
See, now DEF CON would be a good CTF oriented group there.
I'm actually one of the few CTF teams in Singapore. So for those who don't know, that CTFs are security competitions where you do hacking and stuff like that. And right now the scene here is really, really quiet, so I want to bring that up, and I think DEF CON SG would be a really good place to do that.
So that's awesome. So there you go. You guys talked. What was your?
I go by Eamon, but my real name is Jeremy.
Okay. So Jeremy has already volunteered to start. So talk to Jeremy after this, and he is 100% responsible for it. Now, thank you, everybody. Yay! That's called social engineering, by the way. Another example. It's like so. So any other questions? Because there's gonna be. If not, I'll start going to the pointing part. And the guy that I was on the point to already said something, so someone else is on the hook. Any questions? Just saved that guy. Okay. Yes.
What's the most restrictive rate limiting engagement
that you've ever seen? Oh, wow. That.
I know that if no rules, it'd be easy.
I tell people it's like I've got a perfect story on scope. It's like because everybody know what scope is, right? You go to your client, you're a red team, a pen tester, and they tell you, it's like, we want you to attack us just like an attacker would, okay? And an attacker scope is this. This is an attacker scope, right? This is it. Kitchensink.exe, they throw everything at you, right? And you go, okay, I can do that. I can attack you just like an attacker can. And they're like, awesome. But we got to do it between Monday through Friday. It's like, you know, because we got to make sure our support team is there and stuff. And you're like, okay, but attack us just like an attacker would. Okay, I've got this to work with. Sure, okay. Oh, wait, hold on. But don't do it after 3 a.m. to 7 a.m. because that's our production time where we're patching and stuff, you know, our development cycle. So don't do it that time, during that time. But attack us just like an attacker would. And I'm like, sure, I'll attack you just like an attacker would. Awesome, that'd be great. But not all our IPs, because we know we've got some of the production servers that are going to have... No, can you do... Here's this one developer server and stuff on this IP address. Go after it. But attack us just like an attacker would. And I'm like, sure, this will be realistic. I will attack you just like an attacker would. It's like, and that's usually your scope, okay? So I was asked to this was a delicate situation because they're still pissed at me. But the network side, I get subcontracted out by a lot of networking pen testing companies because I do physical. I like to break in because, I mean, anybody, I can do, if you put my arm around my back instead of enforce me, I can do the network style attacks and stuff, but I don't like doing that because it's just not as fun. Because when I do it physically, you actually have to take me to really cool places. So it's like I get to break in and piss people off personally, which is my forte. The networking pen testing company successfully broke into a state treasury in the United States. And I cannot tell you what state because, like I said, they are still mad at me. And they do not play nice. So they brought me in to show them because they were saying, oh, well, there's no way you could physically get in to break this. You'd have to be in our internal network and you can't get in there. And they're like, Jayson, can you come here and show them? And I'm like, sure, I'm on my way because I get to break into a state treasury. That's awesome, right? It's like, I'm never going to break into a shoe company in Des Moines, Iowa, okay? But like hotel, I've broken into hotels in the south of France and Malaysia and the U.S. and banks in Lebanon, Jordan, Jamaica. I mean, I only take the really cool ones and stuff, you know, because it's like, why not? And it's like, so I go to the state treasury and my scope, I kid you not, was this. Because I saw their headquarters and their headquarters was awesome. And I don't mean that facetiously. I'm actually saying they had a very good, well thought out physical layout and protections in their headquarters. They had the bulletproof glass. They had the reflective on it where it's hard to see in. They had cameras placed exactly where they're supposed to be, monitoring the doors. Their lobby area for the receptionist was a door here, and then you had to be buzzed in to get, and you had to go through the receptionist area to get into one of the private areas, and you had to have a visitor's badge on, and she was looking. I mean, they paid her extra to look mean. It's like, I mean, it was a secure facility. I found a way in, though. For the record, I did find, if you went to the basement of that building, there was a cafe there, a lunch area, and there was a storage area down a hallway, and you could go into that storage area. There was a dumbwaiter, which is like, you know, the dumbwaiters, like the garbage chutes that are here, it's like the high rises. So there was a dumbwaiter that actually accessed from the basement to the front, to the first floor, that wasn't sealed. So I technically could have gotten in there, but I looked in the dumbwaiter thing, they had spiders, so it was impenetrable. I could not get in because they wouldn't let me have a flamethrower, so I couldn't get in. They won. They won that round, okay, because I don't know what Trump spiders, okay, but I haven't heard of it yet. So I couldn't get in there. But they did have an office building about 50 miles away that was directly connected to their internal network. Humans think physically. They don't think logistically. So they're like, well, we don't have to worry about the security. That's 50 miles away. So it's in an office building. I'm like, dude, I sit on a computer in that office. I'm like sitting right next to your state treasurer. I'm on the same network. But you're 50 miles away. No, it doesn't work like that. You know, none of this works like that. So what I do is like, so I say, well, if I'm going to be an attacker, a real attacker, I'm going after your office building. And they're like, okay, Jayson, go after our building. Attack us like an attacker would. But you can only go in after 5:30 in the evening. You can't talk to anybody going in or out of the building because we don't know if they're state employees. Oh, you can't use, you know, your hacking tools to break into the doors. I mean, that's not lockpicks. I don't know how to do lockpicks very well. I do crowbars or paper. It's like, because I have broken into so many buildings using paper and cardboard to open up the motion sensor on the other side that I don't need anything else. And what that doesn't work, well, that's where the crowbar comes in. So that usually works. So I couldn't use any of those things. So, and then they were like, if you do get in, it's like you can't use any of those, but if you do get in, it's like you can only get in the lobby area. You can only stay in the public space, but you can only talk to the cleaning crew. But you can't lie to them because they're not an employee. So let me get this straight. Only after 5:30, no crowbars or cardboard, only the public areas, cleaning crew, no lying. Sure, let's see what happens. What happens, I got in. It's like, and it's actually on video. It's like on my Breaking Bad thing. I actually break it down, and you hear the audio and video. You actually hear me talking to the cleaning crew lady, and I tell her nothing but the truth. I tell her that I was working late that night. I was on the clock, okay? The company hired me to break in. It's like, I told her that I had just gotten from the bathroom. I was in that lobby area for over 2 hours, you know? It's like, there was a bathroom break involved. It's like, I told her I didn't have my employee badge. I didn't say it was their employee badge. I have a valid employee badge for my day job. I did not have it with me at the time. Okay. And I was like, I just need to, so I could not get into the suite because no crowbar. And it's like, and I only needed to do one thing, which was destroy their network. It's like, so I mean, I told the, everything I said was 100% absolutely the truth. And she let me in. So their scope was like this, and that proves one important thing. That doesn't prove, and one of the key things is when I show videos, like, it's never showing me like, oh, how cool, or like I was able to get it. No, that wasn't like my skill level. That's how bad we've got security right now. That's not a testament to my skill. That's damnation to our industry right now on what we've got. And so, I mean, why we have, when you get a new employee, do you teach them how to lift the equipment, how to operate the equipment, how to make the widgets or sell the widgets or market the widgets? Or do you just let them have full reign of everything on the first day you hire them? Oh, we hired you. You must know what you're doing. Go do it. No. You have orientation, right? You have a 3-month training period or a 3-month lessons of where you start educating those employees on how to do their job. Why are we not, during that time, teaching those employees that your job is not just to make the widgets, but to secure the widgets? Your job is not just to market the widgets, but to secure the widgets. It's like, if we start teaching them from the get-go that security is not an add-on, not a burden, but one of their responsibilities for them to keep their job, keep their paycheck, and helps them feed and clothe their family, guess what? They'll secure it. Users aren't stupid. If you want to know how smart and resourceful and crafty your users are, take solitaire.exe off your computer. See how quickly that comes back, okay? You'll see how resourceful they are then. It's like, you take something like that from them, you'll see it comes back, okay? They're not stupid. So you teach them and make them part of your security team. Stop making them a burden and make them an asset. That is the biggest, most effective intrusion detection system you're ever going to have, because they do the same job over and over and over. They are going to notice the minute discrepancies. They are going to notice when something goes wrong. Do they know who to call? Do they know how to report it? And if they don't, guess what? That's our fault. That's our failing them, not them failing us. So I broke into a bank in Amman, Jordan. The bank manager was not screaming. She was very polite, which I don't know if I would have been this polite, was telling me very strongly that I should not be plugging the USB drive into the computer. And the whole time she was doing that, I was going, you're right, I shouldn't be doing this. You should call someone. Do you have, hold on a second. Do you have a number to call someone? Because I shouldn't be doing this if you don't know what this is. You should call somebody. You should let them, hold on. I know I'm supposed to be doing this, but if you don't think I'm supposed to be doing this, then I shouldn't be doing this. You should be calling somebody. I mean, hold on. It's like, yeah, you should definitely let someone know about this. It's like, I don't know. I don't want you to think, I mean, I know I'm doing the right thing, but I don't, if you don't know, I mean, hold on. It's like, you know, five machines I plugged it in. With every one of them, her telling me that I'm not supposed to plug it in. But she didn't know who to call. She didn't know how to report that. She didn't know what to do when that occurred. Who failed her? That wasn't her fault. That was the security team's fault. Do you know another thing that doesn't cost any other money, and it's not a blinky box? An extension that everybody knows in the company, that if you see something suspicious on your computer, if you see someone suspicious in the company, call this number. Someone responds and will talk to you and respond to it and let you know that, okay, thank you, we have it under advisement. How does that right there will save you so much down in the long run. Maybe not short term, but eventually it will start getting to people so they understand that they can be empowered, that they have a way or a means to help secure the company. That it's just not a ideal, it's not just a poster, it's something they can actively do. So that's how you do that. Any more questions? Or this guy's gonna get it right here. It's like, yes.
Do you ever get caught?
That's a good question. We gotta qualify it. Have I ever gotten caught by accident or on purpose? I have never, ever gotten caught by accident. It's like every time I've gotten caught, it was me consciously trying to get caught. What I do is I do usually a 3-day engagement. I spend the first 2 days being the worst possible thing that's ever happened to you in your whole entire life, the worst possible thing at the worst possible time in the worst possible way. I'm great at parties. It's like on the third day, I spend the whole day getting caught. I spend the whole day trying to get caught. I go from, I need access to the server room, we're having this surprise. What part of surprise inspection do you not understand? If you knew about it, it wouldn't be much of a surprise. I need access to the server room or you're on the report. I start off that way to, can I get in the server? I got a request. I got to be in the server room to get on the thing. The supervisor, Johnson needs to let me in. He said you could let me in. It's like, and then who are you going to catch on that one, right? It's like, I try to change it so I get caught. there was one time, this was really bad, because sometimes I've had to try harder to get caught than others. And this one branch, this bank, I was trying to break in, and, well, not trying to break in, sorry, not trying to break in. That was super easy, okay? I was trying to get caught. And I'm literally sitting down behind the branch, and I'm like twirling in the chair, and I'm like, I'm not supposed to be here. And there's a server, there's a desk right here with a server underneath, a big desktop server stuff, and it's doing bank stuff, right? It's actually doing processing and whatever it's supposed to be doing. And I'm like, no one's catching me. I am a bad guy. And it's like, I'm doing, and so I tapped the teller, and I said, what's the user ID and password to get to the server? He tells me it. The user ID, same as the password, which was the same as the server name that was available right there. So hard. It's like, so I log into it and I do a graceful shutdown of that server in the middle of a business day while they're doing bank business stuff. I shut it down. I unplug the server. I grab that puppy and I start walking out the door. And I'm like, maybe, just maybe, they'll notice this. Okay? And the teller, it's like, comes up, and it's like, he sees me, he's like, and he finally, wait, maybe this, you know, white guy in my country shouldn't be here. Let me, should ask him. It's like, and he comes up, and he's like, and he says, like, excuse me, it's like, what are you doing with the server? I could have come up with 5 different lies in 3 seconds that would have convinced him to let me do it. As soon as he stopped me and he said that, I was like, oh, you caught me. Oh my gosh, you're good. It's like, how did you know I was a bad guy? That's what I was doing. I was doing a test, and you passed. You were awesome. I mean, it took you logging me in and giving me the password and user ID, but you caught on eventually, and that was perfect. Because you got to give them a win. It's like, I did a job at this one facility, and that's when I had my epiphany. It's like, I was so busy on trying to win and trying to break that I wasn't doing a very good job of educating. I wasn't very good. So I wasn't really providing all the value I could to the client. If we just show them how they fail, we're not giving all the service to the client. We've got to, because we're dealing with humans, we're dealing with human nature. We got to give them ways to show what they can do right, not just all the ways they've done wrong. And this lady, I followed in behind her, walked in behind her, and I got in to the facility. And I compromised 3 different machines. It's like, I went into each office and I was like, I'm with the IT department and stuff, you know, TCP IP reset, you know, flux capacitors, let me plug it in, right? And it worked. And so I'm walking out of the hallway and I see her down the hall talking to someone, very concerned looking. And I mean, I'm a social engineer, I'm very good at reading body language. I know she's discussing, she's realized she's made a mistake. She realizes I'm not supposed to be there. The door for me to leave is right there. If I walked out, I won, right? I succeeded. I compromised 3 machines already. Technically, I already won. But then I had this epiphany. For the first time, I realized, but what if I let her catch me? What if I fail? What if I give them the win and show that even though she made that one mistake, she fixed it and she did something, and this is how she caught? What would I give them then? And so I walked forward and I didn't go through the door. And it's like, and I went to another office and this guy came in and he was like freaking scary. I mean, he was like their IT guy. He's like, I don't know who you're supposed to be. And I'm like, oh, dude, you know, it's like, get out of jail free card right here. Don't hurt me, you know? And that gave them a win. That gave them something to look up to. That gave them something to actually work on and act on. And so from that moment on, every engagement I've done, I've made sure to get caught. I've made sure to get it. Because it's not about getting caught. It's about providing value to your client. It's about giving them teachable moments to their employees, giving teachable moments to their executives to show them where they can improve on security and show them actual real-world exercises in bad guys coming in and doing bad things. That's where we give them value. We don't give them value by breaking their machines or breaking their network or getting root or gathering shell. We give them value when we show them how to protect against getting shell and getting root. When we show them ways to teach them to prevent that from happening, that's where we provide them value. If you have a client and you totally destroy them, and then the next year you go in and you destroy them in the exact same way, you suck. You're horrible. It's like, because that means you didn't really give them much value. You didn't show them the importance of that. And you can't blame that, well, the management just didn't do my recommendations. You need to make sure they understand that. You need to give them that teachable moment. You need to give them that impact. And if you don't do that properly, then you suck. Stop blaming it on the user every time. Stop blaming it on the clients or insecure executives. That's on us. That's on our industry. We need to start being valued to our clients, not just by breaking it, but by showing them how to fix it. I get ranty all the time, by the way. It's like, so that never goes. So you always got to catch me every once in a while. I'll just keep going for hours. And it's like, so have I been going for hours, actually? It's like, okay. So any more questions? Yes.
Which, which culture is easier for you to break in? I mean, is it easier to break in an Asian country?
Nope. There is no... People like to say... I mean, I've actually been accused. It's like one person actually told me, he's like, yeah, you're really great, Jayson, exercising white privilege and getting in and walking in. And I'm like, I broke into a bank on the west coast of the United States with a blue work shirt that said DEFCON on it, with a fake name, a fake phone number, and a fake company name. And I signed into the log of the bank branch. And then I had them walk me through behind the teller line, through the drive-thru area, around the ball. I made the bank manager get out of their desk, off out away from their desk, to plug in a palm plug behind their desk. Did I have to do it to them? No, it was just funnier that way, okay? It's like, because I used the manager to actually, I love using, I sent a phishing email one time, basically by spoofing the head of the company, telling them that there's a problem with phishing emails and they have to be careful of it and they need to read the company's policies as it relates to emails and how to be safe on it. And the PDF was the actual attachment that was the attack on how to prevent yourself from getting caught with phishing emails. Because it was hilarious. It's like, that's the way my mind works. So the whole thing is, it doesn't, there is no culture. There is no Asian culture or European culture. It's like there's different attacks. It's like you can do passive, where it's like, I need you to help me something. There's more the authority role that I've already used. It's like there's different ways to do it, but it's human nature. And there's one thing that I have learned traveling, and I've circumvented the earth a couple times. I've been to a lot of different cultures, a lot of different countries. And the more you see, the more you realize how petty and invisible borders are, because you're just dealing with people. It's human nature. There is no culture for that. It's just human nature. We all have that curiosity. We all have that, well, I don't want to get anybody in trouble. It's like, you know, I don't want to rock the boat. It's like, I don't want to, he looks legit. It's like, I mean, I'm not going to stop him. He should be here and stuff, you know? It's like, I mean, I broke into this one place and I was wearing a work shirt that said hacker on it. It's like, I broke, there's a, on Hacker Strip, they're actually doing the new one where I was breaking into a place in New York City, right across the street from Ground Zero, where they had 8 security guards in the lobby area around the main elevator lobby area, before you even went into the top lobby where the actual business was. And there was like a SWAT team guy with canines and machine guns. It looked really scary. I was wearing a shirt that said, your company's computer guy. And using a forged email, I was able to get full access to that company. It's like, that was not culture. That was not white privilege. That was just bad security. It's like, so that's how that works. So yeah, there is no set culture. There's no one that's easier than the other. It's just, if you give me a human, it's like, yeah, I can probably break it. So.
So you were on the... Have you actually broken into any like military organizations? Because military organizations tend to produce knowledge.
With authorization or without? No, I'm joking. Wait, crap, this is being recorded. No, never. I'm not done with her.
I do understand that military organizations will come up and say, hey, you know what? You have like 10 guys with, you know, full battle order and all that. You know, they can just shoot you anytime if you actually
That would make me sad.
And on top of that, our networks are air gapped, man. It's like, what can happen?
There's only one thing worse than no security. There's only one thing worse. A false sense of security. And any place that you're going to find a false sense of security is a place where guys have guns. Because I got guns. I can shoot stuff. No one's coming in here. And that's probably one of these. I've never had that. It's like, you know, I've never gotten in there. It's like, there's no way I'm ever getting top secret clearance for any country, okay? It's like, there's just too much stuff that I do and things that I get into trouble for. So that's not going to happen. So I don't think I'm ever going to be able to get a chance to break into a military place by invitation. It's like, I might be able to get a chance to break out of one eventually, but it's like, but I'll never get a chance to break into one. So, but it's still the same thing. It's like, there are so many different ways and stuff, you know. I know this one kid who was like, he was able to find a way to break out of NORAD and stuff, you know, using some surgical tools and blended in with a tour. Wait, no, that was War Games. Sorry, it was a movie. Sorry. But no, it's like, I was hoping someone would catch that one because I thought that was hilarious. I don't know if military actually has a better sense of security. It's like, the problem is not their security posture, because they got lots of big guns and a lot of big cameras. Their problem is the same thing with a bank and their tellers, okay? Because what are tellers trained for? I compromise banks all the time. Those tellers aren't stupid. I'm not using their weakness like that. But what do we've taught tellers? If a guy comes in with a ski mask and a shotgun, you do this. You do this, then you do this, then you do this. And that's ingrained to them because they understand that. They have been trained for that. They know how to respond to that in a proper way. Okay? If I come out onto an army base with a tank, I'm going to have a bad day because they're waiting for that. They were trained on that. They know what happens when guys come in with guns and machine guns and you know, paratrooping in. They've got contingencies for all those things. Do they have contingencies for the laundry guy? Do they have contingencies for the guy who's coming in with the pizza? Do they have contingencies for the guy who's coming in with the FedEx package? Do they have a guy who comes in with the janitorial crew? Do you think that power stations and power areas and reactors are heavily guarded? Like in the U.S., do you think they'd be like heavily guarded? I know someone personally that went to Walmart, okay, which is a big mega store, bought a plaid shirt, blue jeans, and bought a weed whacker, you know, like a gardening tool, a big power gardening tool thingy. And what did he do? He got in his pickup truck, went in with the lawnscapers, bypassed everything. Lawnscapers like, hey, we got extra work, no problem, you know? And he did work for an hour or two. And then he had full access to the power plant, and he could have taken out three different states in the United States and stuff and taken out all of their power. It's like, because security. It's like they weren't expecting that kind of attack. It's like bank tellers know ski mask and shotguns, not geek with USB drive. So we're not training them that. Guards know, military guards know, hey, armed invasion, armed shooters, armed bad guys. You know, it's like not, hey, I'm here from IT. We're trying to do something from command. This is an email that I've got. Always use an email on an iPad because iPads are magical. And also you can forge them so much easier. If I would have forged a document on paper, humans will not take that because they realize, no, that's not legit. You could just print that out. You put it on an iPad. Oh, it's on an iPad. That's an actual email. That looks official. Look how shiny that is. It's like, I think that's the new iPad, too. He might be working with the general. It's like, you know? So that's how that works. It's like, that's what you use on that.
Not a question, but actually a comment on this one. I've had the discussion with battlefield infosec guys in the UK. The context was me as a Blinky Box vendor, not as a investor. But the guys whose responsibility is infosec, they know they have a problem. What keeps them awake at night is how to protect the machines that are used for communication in a battlefield environment. That scares the crap out. Because as in every other environment, there is upward pressure on the complexity of the software that they're having to secure, and the complexity of the function that their software is performing. So exactly the same reasons that our smartphones are vulnerable now applies a decade or two behind to equipment that's used by soldiers in battlefields. And I don't mean pilots and Navy who have big complicated fighting machines, I mean infantry.
Sorry, Ron.
So this is, sorry, discussion. So a decade ago I was a Blinky box vendor in the UK, mm-hmm. and we had discussions, but we didn't proceed to a sale, with a UK military department, InfoSec people. And this was specifically about battlefield systems, it was not about base systems at all. And yeah, they know they've got a problem. And their problem is that because of the capabilities that that IT delivers, the capabilities that they're delivering and protecting in battlefield environments are getting more and more complicated, which makes securing what they're doing more and more difficult. And yeah, ours was part of intrusion prevention, part of intrusion detection. It was exactly that problem.
Right.
It was not how do we stop stuff going wrong. It was how do we find out.
Right.
And how can we build stuff into systems that can be deployed in battlefields with battle units and provide that visibility.
Right. Attackers love complexity. Yeah. Complexity is awesome for the attacker. Because the more complex the system is, so much easier to screw it up, right? My whole thing is, I was just using it today. It's like, we're hackers. We can make this more complicated. You know, it's like, that's what we do. So it's like, we love complexity. It's like, because it's just hard to defend against. Any more questions? It's like, I can go for hours, so it's going to be till someone shoots. You already had your... No, what's your question?
Okay, so before you started all this, what were you doing? How did you get this job?
I was a janitor at McDonald's. Actually, that was one of my first... I'm very proud of that. I was one of the best janitors for 2 years in a row at the Southeast Texas region of McDonald's. So I was very proud of that. I was a very good janitor. But no, I started in 2000. I started in 96. Crap, I'm old. 20 years ago, I started in IT. It's like around... No, it was... yeah, it was around 96. It was around 95, 96. I started in IT, doing desktop support, help desk. And then in 2000, I found out that you could do security, which I've always loved. I always liked being the security guy and stuff, you know, and trying to help. I was never one of those security guys that's like, respect my authority and stuff, you know. I was not one of those guys, okay? It's like, I actually honestly love helping people, okay? I like to be able to secure people. I like going after bad guys. So I found out that in 2000, you could do computers and security, and no one shoots at you, because I've actually been shot at, and it's not fun. It's not at all. Trust me on that one. You can take my word for it. Don't try it. It's not good. So I started doing information security 16 years ago. It's like, it's been fun. It's like, this is one of the things I have to stress. If you want to get into information security because you think it's a good career choice and it's profitable, you're going to have a bad time. Okay, it's going to suck for you, okay? Because this is not something you do for a paycheck that you clock in and clock out. Because the people that you're going after and the people that are coming after you, they're having a blast. They're having a great time. And if you don't have that same kind of passion and that same kind of drive to constantly keep learning, constantly understand what the new attacks are out, constantly figure out what the new vectors are, constantly trying to figure out ways to how they're going to get in, then it's just... You can make money off of it and stuff, you know, but I don't think it's going to be that fun. I wouldn't recommend it. It's like, and quite frankly, I don't want you in the industry with me if you're going to be that way, because, you know, that makes it crappier for me. It's like, so I'm very selfish. So do it if you've got a passion. Do it if you really want to figure out how things work, if you really want to figure out how to secure things, and you like knowing that there are people out there that are just doing nothing but trying to steal from you and take advantage of other people that don't know how to do these things, and you get to screw with them, and you get to make their days horrible and stuff, you know, and you get to make them like have really bad days. That makes it fun, and that makes it worth it. So that's what you should be doing.
One more thing. So recently, it's like there's been lots of data leaks, like Panama Papers are out and Snowden is out, and we are at the up ramp of when it comes to leaks. So, I've got any more. So, how do you actually prevent that?
All right. Well, when it comes to Snowden, see, this is the beauty of, like, this is one of the reasons why I'm never getting top secret. Because let's talk about Snowden for a second, okay? One of the things I hate about the Snowden leak is, like, you know, everybody talks about, like, well, we found out that the NSA is spying on us this way, and we found out that the NSA is using these kinds of. Who cares? I pay taxes. My government's supposed to spy. That's what they do. That's part of their job. Your government spies. Everybody spies. That's what we pay taxes for, right? It's for their ability. That's not what pissed me off. But what should infuriate everybody, what should upset everybody, is that the National Security Agency couldn't protect the secrets they were spying on from a contractor with a USB drive. That was pathetic. I don't care if you're snooping on what porn I'm looking at. You don't let someone else share it with the rest of the world. You secure that stuff. It's like, that's what the problem was. Everybody talked about Snowden, like, oh, Snowden showed about how the NSA is doing. Screw that. Talk about how a contractor stole a USB drive from the National Security Agency. What kind of people who have a job, 9 to 5, stealing secrets, can't keep the secrets they're stealing? That sucks! That was horrible!
This is the same government that contains the sort of the HR function, the name I forget, that was storing all of the...
OPM! Yes!
The S86 sort of...
Yeah, everybody giving crap to Hillary Clinton about having her own email server, like the government was doing any better.
Giving it to an Argentinian contractor who worked for a Chinese contractor.
Yeah, it's like... America. But, it's like, yeah, exactly. But like I said, it's like, so yeah, I don't have anything, like, in the Panama Papers, it's like the leaks. Those are mostly insider threats. It's like, and that's one of the things that I tell people, it's like, we talk about, we're trying to keep all these walls and trying to keep all these, and it's like, and 9 times out of 10, it's going to be someone inside using user ID and privileges, and that's the reason why you have things like this that are actually abusing the privileges and rights that you already gave them. They're not dropping 0 days and stuff, you know, to break into your network, unless you're, you know, got a central nuclear centrifuge or something in Iran. They're not dropping that many O-days on you, right? It's like, but what they are doing is they're using the rights that you already gave them because they're an employee, or they're using the rights that you already gave the employee that they compromised because they sent a phishing mail from a Nigerian prince that the person clicked on because, hey, you never know, you might get lucky, right? And that's the problem. So yeah, there's always going to be that. It's like there's always going to be those kind of leaks. It's like, always insider threat is going to be usually one of the biggest things, because it doesn't matter how big and let's face it, China has a really great wall, right? It's like, you know, how many times was that overcome? At least 2 times recorded history. Was it ever compromised? Was the Great Wall of China ever compromised based on its architectural design? No. It was always because of the human element. Subterfuge or bribery. Those are the only times it was breached. Not by so it doesn't matter how big your network is and how great you've got it defended. When you've got that insider threat, when you've got the, someone that's already behind the walls letting it out, that's your issue. And Snowden was the perfect example of that. It's like, and still it's just, oh my gosh, stupidity. So... sorry for the other American here who's like very uncomfortable now. It's like, I don't, oh, by the way, as you can tell, I represent no one else but me, okay? My opinions are mine only, and, you know, everybody else can cringe the way they cringe. Yes?
I have a couple of questions. So the first one is, have you have any fail assignment? That means you can't get into the defined system. My guess is no. The second question is no, because it's so because the system and the whole business and the whole corporation is so sophisticated, so there's so many attack vectors and all that. So you're saying that the easiest way to secure a system to be as simple as possible. But as a big corporation, there's so many things that they do. They have HR, they have the operation, they have so many things that they do. How do you advise them to secure a big corporation? And you can't advise somebody to you can prepare like a bank teller for somebody with an arm comes in with a
right.
gun. But how do you get everybody prepared for all sorts of vectors out there? How do you know the numbers of them?
Well, that is called lobbying a softball, because you just gave me a whole nother way to rant on something that I've talked about. Is I create something. One of the things talking about the open architecture, when we talk about the walls, it's also the coconut principle. Everybody know the coconut principle? Hard outer shell, nice juicy center. Okay? My principle of infrastructure to help prevent that, I call it the submarine infrastructure. I should trademark it eventually because it's going to take off, I know, one day. Okay? Because what's so... The name. But you never know. I can put some rockets on that. We're hackers. We can do something. Okay? We can make... Challenge accepted. So it's like... actually, Spaceship Yamamoto was close. Okay? So it's like... So there's been nautical devices in space. So the submarine infrastructure is one of the ways that networkings have to go to. We have to start adopting that kind of infrastructure. Because what happens when a submarine gets breached? What happens when a submarine gets hit? Does it automatically sink? Does it automatically get destroyed? No. A compartment will be breached. You can seal that compartment off, and the submarine still functions. The submarine can still maintain until that breach is fixed. You've lost that compartment. That compartment's toast and stuff. You know, there might be some people in there floating around, and I feel sorry for the families and stuff, but the rest of the submarine is intact. We need to start developing our networks like a submarine, because is there ever a time in your network environment, in your corporate environment, that HR needs to contact the web developer servers? Is there ever a time when the web developers need to talk to the executives' servers? You need to start segmenting your networks not based on IP addresses, but by job roles. You need to start segmenting your network and understand that your internal network is just as hostile as your external network. It's like when you start designing your network to withstand an internal breach and attack, and wall that off, that's when you get crypto locker by HR, and it just attacks HR, but everything else is safe because it can't communicate outward. It's like one of the key things in my day job stuff, you know, it's like I work for a financial institution during the day, believe it or not. It's like they don't, but I do. I still show up. They still give me a paycheck, so it's all good. It's like, show up most of the time. So... But what happens there is that we don't allow port 80 to the desktop. It's like you have to go into a Citrix environment to a VMware that is snapshotted to get out. It's like we set up where these ports are open on this part to this. It sucks when you build it. It sucks when you implement it. It saves you hours, money, bandwidth, and time once it's done. And that's where you go from. That's how you sell it to your executives. It's like networking guys hate it at first, because networking and security, when have we ever gotten along, right? Network, we got to make things faster. We got to make things faster. Network's like, wait, slow it down. We got to inspect it. And, you know, they're like, we're always like this. But once you show networking that your network runs better and faster and smoother, when it's more segmented, when it's more controlled, then networks going to go, oh, that might be an actually good idea and stuff, you know? Because maybe you don't need that BIOS talking to the whole entire environment, right? It's like you can cut that. You can change that. One of the other things, and I'm losing the thought as I come up with it. That one's gone.
Have you ever failed?
Oh, the first, no, I mean, not unless I tried. It's like, I mean, and once again, it's not a testament to my skill. I really don't think I'm that, there's a lot of people in this industry that are way better than me, okay? Probably one of the most animated and adorable, okay? But there are a lot of people a lot more talented and skilled than I am, okay? It's like, I'm also one of the loudest, so it's like, but, no, it's not a testament to skill. It's just that we need to educate more, and we got to get people out there to be better at defending themselves. So, yes, I don't have it. That was another part about the network. I'm sure we're just all going to assume that it was very witty and insightful and go from there. So, next question.
I'm just curious, right? Because you were mentioning, right, that it's actually possible to prevent all this, right? But all this social engineering, right, it depends a lot on, it's so targeted, there's a lot of pretext that's behind it, right?
Yep.
So, is there really a program that's possible to use to educate all the bank tellers and whatever?
Is there something we can educate? Yes, you educate the bank tellers and you educate your users as a standard opening employment. You create, there are companies that actually work on security awareness programs for you that'll give you training lessons, that'll give you training videos, that'll help raise security awareness. But one of the things that you can do that once again costs no money is have your security team go through your environment, through your office building. And what they do is, once a quarter, they go through every building that you have, every floor that you have, and you can do it like one floor this quarter, then another floor the next quarter. So by the end of the year, you'd visited everybody at least once. And all you do is you have your security team walk through the floor very professionally, and they look under the keyboards. You go to the next station, look under the and you're looking for passwords. And you think that's funny, you're going to find passwords on the first sweep. I promise you that, okay? It's like you cannot not find passwords underneath the keyboard. I don't know what's so magical about that effing keyboard that it protects secrets like that, but you will find them, okay? So what happens after that? What does that do? That doesn't just secure your network and show them that they can't write passwords, but that shows them that you exist because you're not tangible. Information security is this nebulous thing that you know that's on the other side of the email telling you to change your password and stuff, you know? That's who those guys are. We suck at detecting threats from virtual into real life, right? Who plays Call of Duty Black Ops 3? Come on. Whatever, come on. I play it all the time. I mean, come on. And you know how I play games? You know how I play Black Ops 3 multiplayer first-person shooters? Because I also like playing Unreal Tournament 2004 because that's still awesome. That's still the bomb. Unreal Tournament 2004, they need to get another one because Unreal 3 doesn't count because it sucks. But it's like, but when those first-person shooters, there are some guys that play that game and they are like, okay, Roger 3, okay, what we're going to have is we're going to have, I've known this map and stuff, you know, it's a real short-term map, so I need our one sniper on our left flank. It's like I want our two heavy gunners and stuff, you know, to go on the right flank. I'm going to have our medium weapons guy go down. And I'm going, as soon as the game starts, I'm like, Leroy Jenkins, boom, 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 boom. Pew, 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 America, boom, boom, boom. And I die. And like, okay, I respawn, pew, 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 America, boom, boom, boom. And I'm shooting again. I'm a running gunner. Screw the whole, I'm there to have fun and shoot things, okay? I don't know about anybody else. But now, put electrodes to me. If you strap me up with electrodes, and every time I got shot in the game, I got a nice little 1,000-volt jolt, how would I be playing? Pew! Pew, pew! America, pew, pew! You know, that's how I would play, because I would realize that what happens online happens and affects me in real life. When you start showing the employees that you exist, that what they do online and on that computer will have real world repercussions by a security person visiting at their desk, they will change their tune. An employee sends an illegal attachment. You send them an email. You restrict their access. They download a virus. You send them an email or you restrict their access or something. Go to their desk. Whenever I go to a new on the job and stuff, you know, someone sends something like that, I don't go in there all adorable, like, hey, you know, excuse me, can you get out of your seat for a second? I'm with information security, I need to look at your computer. And you sit down at their computer. They're standing right behind you, up. Everybody around them are trying to look at everything but them sitting there watching you on their computer. And just looking, and I'm literally, I've got this USB drive that's got like PS Exec and it's got some task manager stuff. And it's like, I don't care. I'm not doing an audit. What I'm doing is I'm making them stand up there behind me while I'm working on their computer, showing them that I'm doing something because they did something bad.
And so I'm looking through the computer, and I'm like, gotta give them the glare every once in a while. Sometimes if they really did something stupid, you do the, That gets them, okay? And then you like, you finish whatever you were doing, which was probably nothing. You stand up and says, okay, do you understand the policy about sending illegal attachments through company email? Did you get the memo in our handbook and stuff, you know, what it talks about downloading viruses or opening up suspicious emails that you're not familiar with? Okay, well, you need to reread that. Okay, because we have policies on that. It's like, this could lead to termination or a mark in your file. If we have any other issues and stuff, you know, we will be back. Thank you for your assistance. And I leave. I didn't just educate that person on the real world repercussions of what they did online. I educated the 20 people in the cubes around them going, oh crap, Bob did it again, okay? And then I educated the other 20 people that talk about that in the lunchroom and stuff, you know, did you hear what Bob did in accounting? Oh my God, it's like security couldn't do it, made him stand up. And then probably another 20 and stuff, you know, that read it on a Facebook post, like, oh, Bob did it again, you know? So you educate by creating those real world situations. It's like, once again, $0, a little bit of time, and it creates that impact. It's like, and that's how you show them that what they do online in the computer has real world repercussions. And I remember I had to write that down because I remembered what I was talking about when we talked about the submarine infrastructure. I literally had to quit a job once where I refused to take the client's money. It's like, they hired me, we had the agreement, we had the contract. I went into the environment, and it was a 10.0 network. I mean, literally, it was flat. It was flatter than flatline. It was, this table is bumpy considering how flat this network was. Okay? You know, I talked about the HR and web developers. Screw that, okay? Their web server and email server could be connected to the HR. There was no DMZ. Okay? It was a flat network. It gets better. Well, actually, it gets more tragic, but still. Okay? They had a guest wireless access point that was unencrypted, had the name of the company in it, _ guest, and guess where it was attached? Same freaking network. I've only gotten 2 people fired from their jobs. That networking guy was one of them, okay? And I feel, not really. I was about to say I feel bad, but I don't feel that bad. It's like, I literally said, it's like, I can't take your money because you're trying to get me to break into a network that you've got no locks on the door, okay? I can't break into something that's open. There's no way to do that, okay? It's like, I mean, when you can't tell me to hotwire and steal your car when it's running with the keys in and you actually got it started for me. It's like, that just, it doesn't work that way. So I said, take the money you were going to give me and hire a networking guy and hire a networking company that can come in and give you segmentation that can actually build out your infrastructure, and not that guy. Anybody but that guy. It's like, and if you're going to keep that guy, which you really shouldn't keep that guy, it's like, take him, use that money to give him classes and teach him how to use the network, because he did not know. Or, because either this guy was a complete idiot or a totally malicious insider, okay? There's only 2 options there. It's either incompetence or maliciousness, okay? But usually, when it's between maliciousness and incompetence, incompetence usually wins. So that's probably what it was. But yeah, that was there are companies out there like that. And this was a million-dollar company. This wasn't mom and pop egg shop and stuff, you know, that did the, there was a guy who had a bike shop in Poughkeepsie, New York. And he thought, well, I'm just a little bike shop in Poughkeepsie. Exactly. So it's like, and he's like, so who's going to attack a bike shop in Poughkeepsie, right? So he puts his own web server on his in his shop. And he puts his web page up using that server. It's like in his little bike shop in Poughkeepsie and stuff, you know, no big deal. That's all great and stuff, right? 4 months until the FBI breaks down his door. Because that nice little bike shop in Poughkeepsie was serving porn, malware, spam bots, malicious files, illegal files. I mean, just horrible stuff, because that web server had like 500 gigs. He was using 3 megs, and he didn't have anything protected because he was like, why would anybody bother me? I'm just a bike shop in Poughkeepsie. Guess what? We have a sense of security from a physical standpoint, right? You know who your neighbors are. If you go to the store and you're running down out of the building and stuff, you know, for a minute or two, you don't have to really lock your door because you know who your neighbors are. You know you're safe. It's cool. But when you put a computer on the internet, your neighbors are now Paraguay and Guatemala and the U.S. And not all those guys actually mean you well, right? It's like, because you're not a person here, you're actually a number on a scanner that's looking for vulnerabilities. That's who you are. It's not geographical, it's logistical. So that's what we have to start preparing for and understanding and stuff. You know, it's like, that's what we got to prepare. It doesn't matter the size of the company. It doesn't matter what you do or high value target you are. You're a number on the internet. It's like the great unifier. We're all vulnerable. Yay us. So, it's like, we got to have another question because that's really a downer and stuff to end on. So. Anything else?
So, when you do all this training and stuff, right, teach people how to protect certain vectors, but actors will just come with new vectors to get into the system. So, how do you teach them that the mindset to be aware of it? Because when the info guy comes down,
right,
and opens up a keyboard, they're just going to put a drawer on the monitor.
Right.
That actually happened at the previous company over there.
What do they do now?
They put it under the monitor or in the
Oh. Yeah, you have to evolve. You have to change it. It's like we had that where it's like where they took it out of the they took the password out from under the keyboard, they put it in the drawers. So what we did is at night we'll pick certain floors, not all the floors, but we'll pick like 4 or 5 floors a quarter that with a security guard with me, I'll go in at 3 o'clock in the morning and I look to the drawers. And I find the passwords or something. They understand that it's going to be checked. It's like they, and once again, it's not about trying. I don't want to catch people failing. That's not the ideal. It's like, let them have their passwords. Like, they're going to have them, but they, as long as they lock them up and I can't find it and a bad guy can't find them, that's okay. It's not okay. It's still terrible and horrible. But it's still, it's like, it's not, that's not what the exercise is for. It's the education to let them know that a security team works on. And we talk about passwords. That's one of the biggest problems we have in our industry is because we still think passwords. Do you realize who here uses a Windows environment? It's like, you don't have to raise your hand because everybody's going to raise your hand and they're going to feel bad because they have to use Windows. And now their friends know that they're not using Linux desktops at work because who uses Linux desktops at work, right? So, okay. So do you realize on a Windows network environment that the space key is a valid character for a password? The space bar. So why are we using passwords anymore? Why aren't we using passphrases? It is so hard to remember XWJ34 lowercase colon then a capital exclamation point and stuff, you know, and a capital J. Crap, that's actually my real password. Don't nobody write that down. Wait, this is being recorded too late. Okay? It's like, that's hard to remember, so we have to write that down. But I really hate passwords because they suck, exclamation point with a capital S. It's like, and then putting some apostrophes and having the space bars. I do not have a passphrase or work that's under 26 characters. And it's easier to type in. Because I'm typing a sentence with proper grammar, which is actually probably the hardest part and stuff when you're getting these things together and stuff, you know. But with you do proper grammar, you got apostrophes and you got the little colons, semicolons, you got all those little squiggly things. I didn't graduate high school, so I don't know what they all are. But, you know, you got all those you can use. So start teaching employees how to use those, and they could remember those. It's like their favorite movie quote. It's like, not their favorite movie quote, because I actually broke into a person's machine because it was so hard because they had Walt Disney. It looked like Walt Disney actually came from his grave and threw up on their desk. It was like, Pluto this, Pluto that, and then it was like Mickey this, Minnie that, and another Pluto thing, and then it was like Donald Duck over here, and Chip and Dale, and then Pluto, and guess what their password was? If you're saying Pluto, yes, it was Pluto. It's like, but it was a zero, because they're school, and it's like, there was an exclamation, I don't know what it was. It was a derivative of Pluto. It's like, so it wasn't that hard. It's like, so don't make it your number one. If you got all Star Trek stuff on your thing, okay, don't make Live Long and Prosper your freaking passphrase, okay? It's like, make it, may the force be with you. That might catch them. That might get them by surprise. Okay, you gotta be tricky like that, okay? So you do that. So it's like, so you teach them how to do passphrases. It's like, you teach them how to do that so they don't have to write it down. I can talk for everybody, but everybody wants to leave. It's like, everybody's like, somebody's ironing the door. She's like, oh my God, why did I agree to come here? It's like, so I think we're good. I think, yes, I'll still be here a little bit later if you want to talk some more, but I'm talked out right now. Whew, thank you.
Cool, thank you.
I was getting to the end. It was getting close. Mm.
Be years old. So that's, I think, all for this evening. It sounds like some follow-up with Armin about getting a dev phone group on the ground.
Yeah, so if anyone is interested in joining, creating one of me, come and approach me or something.
If you want to set up a group or whatever, post on the event page.
And go to defcongroups.org, and there's a template, and you just have to fill that out. Oh, you got it. Then, yeah, send it in. So we're just waiting for him to, it's all on him, we're just waiting for him to send it in. We're ready to go. As soon as he sends it in, we're all good. No pressure. I don't want to do that, okay? It's totally up to you. Everybody here is expecting it, but it's just, I mean, no pressure. It's all good.
Yeah, should I just keep everyone my email? So if you have any, I'll just keep everyone my email. So if you guys want to join in,
so yeah, that's not going to end well for you, buddy. But no.
Yeah, give this everybody. So this is.
Oh, okay, it's all good. Okay, yeah.
Oops. I don't even know how to spell my own email. Yeah. Okay.
Ooh.
So it's
Andy Nowell.
Yeah, that's my blog.
Okay.
Yeah, please don't attack it, it's not very well secured. Okay, so basically I am the leader of a group called Nain Owls. We also call Dystopian Owls. We play on CTFs. And what I envision is that maybe this DEFCON SG group could be a place where we can develop CTF skills. And hopefully we can like develop a team to qualify in DEFCON. Not playing yet, we're not there yet, but hopefully Singapore will be represented, especially when this year will be such a momentous CTF with the CGC participating. The CGC, for those who are not aware, right, is where AI fight each other in a DEFCON style CTF. So the winner of the CGC will end up playing in the main event against humans. So this is where the singularity happens.
Deep red.
Yeah. And this is where Skynet starts taking over. So join us, be a part of Skynet. Yeah.
I keep forgetting Skynet's a bad thing. Skynet's a bad thing.
I welcome our robot overlords.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, okay, so contact me if you guys are interested. You can contact me at, never mind, this is enough. Oh, I'm also at NUS Grey Hats. So if anyone's interested in security, we have our Security Wednesdays. If anyone's a student, we have actually a competition going on this weekend.
XCTF.
Yeah, the XCTF. So those who know about it, I wish you well. Hopefully you qualify. You probably qualify because we have quite a few people, very few people participating.
Yeah. One quick thing, what's your dialing code for Singapore to dial Singapore International, from international
plus
to...
65.
To
yeah,
plus 65. 65.
So your group would be DC65.
Okay.
That easy, so that's the DC group. So you'd be DC65. It's like, which is a pretty easy one. Like DCC 4420 is the London group, so it's like they've got like more numbers, but 65 is still a good, nice number there. So
DC,
huh?
Isn't there padding?
Okay. I can't hear you.
Padding?
Oh, 065.
If you want to put the zero, but I don't think they do the zero, but you can do the zero if you want.
I'm not going to tell you not to use the zero. It's like, you're DC group. Zero, no zero. Y'all can, I'll leave that up to committee. Okay? It's like, but I just know there's definitely a six and a five in there involved. So, but yeah, so if y'all want to get that DC group started, that'd be awesome. So, and I think you're on the way to it. So,
yeah,
so yay!
Right now, I think we have about 20 people in my Slack, call it the SGCTF group. So, we would probably grow from that.
Okay, yeah. Cool. And also create a Twitter, DC group Twitter account and stuff, you know, so that way people can see it on Twitter, and it's like you got Facebook.
Yeah.
It's like, so yeah, get that involved and get a website and you're gone. You're good. So once again, thanks to everybody. And against my better judgment, I'm not going to.